From the End of Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mix Master G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, I try to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. For those of you who don't know me, I am a 54-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15, which means you are looking at almost 40 years of DJ experience in the flesh. And I'm happy to share all the knowledge I accumulated over the years with you guys. And that is exactly what these streams are for. You can ask me anything DJ related and especially DJ tech related. I'm no longer active as a working DJ. I do a gig every now and then, but not every weekend, far not every weekend. And just when I really, really want to do it. However, I spend my days making tools and apps that makes the life of DJs easier. The most famous one of those apps is the Record Box, or is the DJ Conversion Utility. And the DJ Conversion Utility allows you to convert cues, loops, DJ metadata in general you've set in one DJ software to a host of other DJ softwares, saving you a lot of time with all kinds of duplicate work. In the announcement of this stream, I've told you that I was going to unveil new features for the Record Box Cue and Key tool. The Record Box Cue and Key tool, REC for short, is my tool that allows easy integration of mixing key data with Record Box. However, there are some new developments, and I cannot get into details about those developments yet because negotiations are ongoing. But these developments in general are positive and will be positive for the DJ community in general. Ongoing these negotiations, again, I cannot get into details about them. I will hold off the release of REC 2.0. So you just have to wait for that a little bit longer. It's not that the release of REC is off the table, far not. It's just postponed at this particular moment. And I hope that sometime soon I will be able to get into more details about this because I'm really excited about it. There are some new possibilities opening up and I think you guys would love it too. So that's that. What's left is also important because last week I had in the news section that Traktor 3.5, the then beta Traktor 3.5, had HID or HID control for short for the new Pioneer CDJ 3000 players, and that I bought myself a pair of those CDJ 3000 players just because. And today it is that moment because the players came in last week, 2 hours after I ended my stream, so we couldn't wait and unbox them anyway. However, it gave me a little time to play with these things, and I really like what I can do with it. So what I will do in this stream is going to do a deep dive with you guys into Traktor 3.5, the Beatport and Beatsource LINK integration it offers, which is also great, and of course HID mode for the CDJ 3000. Before we get to all that, let me first say hi to a couple of people. DJ Cruz, welcome to the stream, my friend. Eddie Brome, very welcome, a regular there. Kevin Basher, my friend, welcome, good to see you. I'm not sure if I'm going to do the CDJ 3000 versus 6000M comparison today. I think, because that's most likely why you are here. For those of you uninformed, on Reddit, there is this man named Bas Curtiz, and Bas is doing tests of various DJ software functionality and then compares that. Bas is most famous for its yearly annual key detection test he does. So he takes like 2,000 tracks and he's going to test how those tracks are analyzed in key by all the DJ software and mixed in key, and then determines which of those is the best. That same Bas Curtiz, let's call him the key specialist, did now a test with the various DJ software. What happens if you are going to use the pitch and you want to use the key lock, for instance, how to track sound. You can find that on Reddit. Maybe I will for sure post the link in the comment section under this video, so you can just watch it. It's very short, but you can see it. But Kevin came up with a good one as well, because the CDJ3000s, and those are these babies, the CDJ3000s are capable of doing a key lock as well. And so are the Denon 6000Ms. So what Kevin was interested in is, hey, how do those players sound if you compare them? The thing is, I noticed that my audio, at least, when I listen to it from the stream, is not as good as the recorded audio. So doing this in a live stream would not help you very much, because you heard it at the intro tune. It sounds a little bit weird, to say the least. And I don't have that problem if I record it. So I think if you want to make a fair comparison of that, I just must do a very small recording of a track and play it on the 6000M and the CDJ3000, and then play a little bit with the key and the pitch control and see what happens to the quality of the sound. So Kevin, I owe you that one. I will see what I can do about it, but not today, because the stream is not the right place for that to do. Then we have, of course, let's see who else we have. Kevin is just here to hear my voice, you little teaser. Mark is asking me when the new rack will be available. I don't know. Like I said, negotiations on the thing I cannot talk about are ongoing. So I'm not sure when I can release it. However, the beta is out, and that is pretty stable. But hey, I didn't say that, so that's a fact. But I'm not going to officially release it. There will not be a press release, basically because I want to have the thing that just happened, see what it can grow into, because it's potentially very, very interesting for everyone involved, including you guys. So it is in your best interest that I hold off. You got it? Let's see what else we got. We got Anthony in the stream. Thank you, Anthony. Welcome. We've got Tito Morales. Hello, Mixmaster G. Thanks a lot for all you do. Appreciate your hard work at time. You're more than welcome, Tito. I really like to do this stuff. If it wasn't fun for me, trust me, then I wouldn't do it, because I'm that kind of guy. I only do things I really enjoy, and I enjoy helping other DJs out wherever I can. That is just something I do. And those, I think I covered most of the basics, or most of the people in the stream right now. Again, guys, great that you signed in. Before we head first into Traktor 3.5, there is another thing I promised somebody, I think, on YouTube during the Digital DJ Tips. And let me cover that as well, because I see a reoccurring theme, especially with the weather getting better, with the world opening up, with the pandemic kind of behind us. The question, what can I do about portable energy when I'm doing events on a location where there is no electricity available? And of course, you can go for a generator. If you go for a generator, make sure that you go for a what is called pure sine generator, and the Hondas seem to have the best cards for that, because that will prevent or protect your valuable electronics. If you just take a good old generator, then the power fluctuations might be too big for most electronics. So don't do that. Make sure it's what is called a pure sine generator. However, I got this thingy, which I usually take with me when I, for instance, go camping, or if I work outside, or if I go on a plane. This is called a solar generator. It's made by Suayoki or something. Looks like this. It's pretty small. It got lights on front in front of it, so it is kind of made of for camping. It also got on the back a power outlet that will provide you 220 volts. It got a battery inside, but Of course, if you are going to use the power outlet right there for powering up your powered speakers, then it will not last very long. The good thing is that it also got these USB connections on the top of it, which can use to load your or charge your telephone. And now comes the interesting part. On the back is a 12-volt connectors. Those are 12-volt connectors. Maybe you can see that. If you use those 12-volt connectors and you combine it with this, let me get that too. This is a charger specifically made for Apple MacBooks. And this is the MagSafe connector you get into the power connector. This is what usually goes into your cigarette lighter. Now comes the fun part, because maybe you can already get it together, but with that Suayoki solar generator, they're called, by the way, solar generators because they're usually used with in conjunction with solar panels. You've got those foldable solar panels and you can connect that too, and then it will be charged with the solar energy and then you can use it later on. That's why they call it solar generators. But it comes with this, and this is goes one end inside the Suayoki battery pack, and the other end is just your regular cigarette lighter, as you can see. Now, if I combine the whole thing together like this, then all of a sudden you can see the light on the adapter on. All of a sudden, I got here my connector for my MacBook. To give you an indication, this thing is capable of powering my MacBook Air for more than 24 hours at full operation. Wi-Fi running, screen full brightness, which is pretty amazing. So when I'm on a plane, for instance, my MacBook Air has already a pretty good power life because it doesn't need that much juice as the bigger CPU processor or the bigger CPU MacBooks. But when I'm on a plane, I can, if I go to the States, easily power my MacBook Air with this set. It is very small. It can fit in your hand luggage. It is legal to take it on a plane. I really highly can recommend them, and they are cheap. They are like 50 euros or something. So really recommended this, and this comes with it. This you need to Google, because this is a little bit harder to find. I don't think it has an official name. There is some tape around it because I stepped on it, but this is a little bit hard to find, and this is the real trick. You can, of course, use your regular AC MacBook adapter in the 220-volt outlet of this of the battery, but then it will drain very fast, because then you have a conversion of a power conversion of a power conversion, and that is just a waste of energy. So I wouldn't recommend it. This is the way to go for this. So that has been covered too. Solar power generators. When you are traveling, then it's time for the main thing of tonight, and that is the CDJ 3000 and Traktor 3.5. Here we are. Let me power this all down and just do it step by step, because there are some funny things going on I didn't expect to happen, and it's always best to just start with a clean slate. So let me quit my Traktor. Let me power down the players. Because you see twice. In other words, it's a piece of hardware that allows you to You have lost microphone. Is my mic? I am sending. Can someone confirm that my audio is working? Because it says that I'm sending. Can so? Oh, maybe. Hello. It says that it is indeed on. Let's see. Back on now. Oh, that might be because I. No, it shouldn't. No, it shouldn't at all. But glad it's on again, my friends, because it's really annoying if I'm. By the way, the regulars know this already. I often forget to switch screens. So I'm in the middle of telling you something and I'm completely convinced that you are seeing what is right in front of me. But I forgot to switch the cams. So that means that you cannot see it. So if that happens, scream it in the chat so I can see that it happened. Alrighty, back to what I was telling you. HID, human interface device. By definition, that means it's just a device made to interface with a computer. And the official definition is an HID stands for human interface device and allows a hardware unit such as a CDJ to send information to and from a computer. The main advantage of using HID versus MIDI is that HID responds to movements as they are happening and with virtually no delay. This is obviously a better choice when controlling DJ software. The last part is not completely correct because latency for HID and MIDI is about the same. However, the big difference is that HID talks to the software directly. It are not MIDI commands, notes, stuff like that sent over a MIDI channel. No, it are commands made to be interpreted by the DJ software. That also makes it possible to do stuff on HID that is not possible using regular MIDI. For instance, if you use a MIDI interface, you cannot have a waveform on the screen moving. That's not possible because that is not covered. You can make little LEDs blink on and off, but that's about the extent of feedback you can give. So latency, I'm not sure that is a big difference between the two. The big difference is the fact that it is made to communicate directly with the software, and it is also made to receive information back and display it if possible. And that is what's happening with the CDJ3000. And that is also why this is such an important thing. Because, for instance, MIDI mapping of jog wheels is a nightmare in Traktor. We can map everything in Traktor pretty easily, and I map a lot myself as well. However, if you want to have just the forward and backward notching of a jog wheel mapped in Traktor, that's an entirely different thing. That's really hard to get covered. So that is about HID. Now, for CDJ players to work on HID, they need to be connected over USB to your Macintosh computer. And that is very important. So the kit you see right in front of me, the mixer, the players, all three are connected to my Mac over USB. By the way, they are also connected over UTP, and UTP provides what is known as the DJ Pro Link, but that is entirely pioneer territory we are in there. And maybe I will get into that later on. One of the unique things that in HID mode, or one of the unique things Rekordbox can do and Traktor cannot do at all, is using HID over UTP, meaning that if you have a mixer like this Nexus 2 mixer connected over USB to your computer and the players are connected to the mixer together over the same network, then you don't need USB to the players. That is not the case if you use Traktor. For Traktor, all the players and the mixer need to have their very own USB connector to the computer. For me, under this player is just a small USB 3 powered hub, and that goes to the USB port of my computer. So basically everything is in the coffin. Under this one is the, behind the mixer is the UTP hub for the network connection. And under this one is the USB hub, and behind this one is the power outlet. Another thing, this coffin was originally made for my CDJ Nexus 2000, CDJ 2000 Nexus 2s. The CDJ 3000s are a little bit wider and they are a little bit deeper than the Nexus 2. That meant that I had to take the foam off a little bit. However, the moment I went to the back, I came with a little bit, there was a little bit of friction with the power outlets because the big Euro connector that is sticking into the player to provide it with power is sticking out a little bit too much for the power strip that is behind it. So that was a bit of an issue that I had to work with. But overall, you can see it just fits. Now, having the whole thing on, we can tell the players that they have to be assigned to Traktor. You do that by selecting control mode right there, and then you have to assign a deck to each player. And something curious happened that I didn't know was possible, but you can assign the players the same deck. Let me show that to you. Both decks are now deck B, and the moment I load a track inside a deck, you see it appearing on both players. So that's a little bit weird. A thing that I find annoying about this all is that you always have to widen your waveforms. I'm a big fan of Traktor waveforms. Traktor is my base DJ software because it is the software I started out with when I started digital DJing, and it always has served its purpose. So because of legacy, it is my software. There are some other things that are important as well, but legacy is the most important one. Now, let me show you something funny here. If I set a cue on this player, it also appears on this player. So these players are really identical right now. They are both player B, and I didn't know that was possible. Now, here's the thing. I did make this player B, and I made this also player B. There is no way to undo it for this player. If I want to assign it a new number, I have to power it down. I struck a microphone off. It says it's even my Sennheiser says it is sending. My OBS says it's sending. Everything says it's sending. I'm not sure what's happening with the mic, people. It might be USB interruption, but in that case, if it was USB interruption, I should see it on my OBS as well. My OBS is just going straight out, so I'm not entirely sure why that is. Is my mic back on, Kevin? Am I back on? By the way, I should take the caption off because we are already started. You guys are, don't tell me anything about that kind of stuff. You should just yell at me. All right, is my audio back on? Great. I think it has to do with my USB bus resetting that the moment because it happened exactly at the same moment earlier when I just repowered the kit, and now I powered on just one player, and maybe something went wrong there. But I see my microphone sending all the time on OBS, so I'm not sure why it is doing what it's doing, but hey, this is technology, right? So let me assign it deck A as we want to do it, and now it's not, the encoder is not reacting, which is also a new thing. All right, mic might be off again, because let's repower both decks then. And let's do this the proper way now. You can see now it will take it. So somehow it was locked up along the way. Again, now one of the things that immediately struck me the moment I was using this is the following. Look, if you look at my Traktor screen, and I let me just link this up directly. Let me make this a little bit bigger. Let's see. Oh, the right screen is better on cam. So let's focus on the B. Let's focus for now on the B deck and this side of the, because that player is better in view. Now, this is reacting exactly the way you expect it to react. The whole feeling of the jog wheel is fluent. It's like an iOS device where you find that usual flowing feel it has. I really like that. You see the same happening on screen in a moment. However, one very odd thing I noticed is that the moment I move my jog back, let's spin it back like 360, so I'm going beyond the track, you see that this is no longer moving. The WAF on my CDJ is no longer moving. On my screen, it is moving. Now, if I press play on this player, it is already playing, and then it picks up later on the screen. So there is somehow the player is not capable of showing nothing. It needs to show something. So if you go in front of the waveform like this, start the player, it already started playing, it picks up, and then the moment it meets each other, they are in sync again, it goes through as normal. I had to get used to that a little bit if I was only looking at the CDJ screen. So for some circumstances, you really, really, really need to have a look on what is happening on the screen in order to make sure that you are indeed doing the thing you are doing. Another thing that I'm missing is the phase indicator. And one of the reasons why Traktor is my preferred DJ software is because of this great phase indicator. Let me show that to you. Let's start this track up. There is no audio there, so it might go offline. And the phase indicator is this little thing there. And of course we can, let's see if we can get it a little bit without audio. And now it is in phase. So now that both tracks are running in phase, I see my BPMs are slightly off. So let's take care of that. But in general, this is fine. This should sound fine. You don't see a phase indicator on the top of the decks anymore. I've dived into all the menus of it. There is no phase indicator anymore. So for those of you who are like me, who really like their phase indicator, the phase indicator is gone. I am not sure if that feature is gone from the CDJ because it seems not to be there if you use them standalone either. So it might be that that was just generally taken away from the CDJs. Hey, I don't know, but I miss it. It was on my Nexus 2s, on my CDJ 2000 Nexus 2, and that's something I miss. But trust me, it's not a reason to go back there, because having 8 hot cues available right at your fingertips is a huge improvement. You can scroll through the deck using the preview exactly the way you expect it to work. If you are familiar with CDJ 2000s in Traktor HID mode, then this will feel right at home for you. This has the exact same feeling to it, but it's smoother, it's more fluent, it just feels a little bit better. All the usual suspects are there. You can set cues, you can release cues. The moment a track is playing, you can set either a 4-beat or an 8-beat cue straight ahead. After that, you can either use touchscreen to make the loop smaller or to increase it. You can also use the buttons. It's just whatever you prefer. If you click it again, it will go away and the loop is deactivated. All this stuff is working exactly the way you expect it to work. If you want to make a beat jump, you can just make beat jumps however you like them to make. Or you can just activate it and set, all right, I want to go 4 back, or I want to go 8 back. and it will just do that for you. The key shift, again, I'm not going to use audio here, but it works just the same. You expect it to work. So everything on the HID mode is working the way you expect it to work. And I think Native Instruments did a great job of integrating all this technology, all this new technology, with the existing software. And it's a job well done. The CDJ2000 Nexus 2 integration, HID integration, was the best I knew, besides Rekordbox, obviously, because that is native Pioneer. That should always work. But with this, this is really what you want. If you want to go back to your playlist, for instance, you can just click the browse button and go back to the playlist. However, the touch screen is not working when you have a playlist open. You have to use the encoder dial and then press the button, and then it will load the track. Another thing that some people like and some people don't is the fact that sometimes it shows in the center disc, in the center jog, the track that is playing. I don't mind, but others find it a little bit toyish. I don't mind. The indicators in the center screen are logical and great. I did dim the screens all the way down to make them make it possible for the cam to pick them up. So that is the reason why this might look a little bit dimmed out, but I wanted to be sure that there is as much information shown on it as there is possible. What else can I tell you otherwise then? This just works exactly the way you want it to work. Now, I see Pioneer DJ getting a lot of heat online from people saying, yeah, but why did it take you guys so long to make HID possible? And this is only possible since the latest firmware update. That is all not true. Pioneer DJ is very clear about this. If they have a new player out, then selected software developers, and those are the big names like Serato, Native Instruments, Virtual DJ, Algorithms DJ, all get access to the same developer's box that makes it possible to create an HID interface. Basically, it's just a box of tools, an API that they can speak to, and then the player will handle the rest. So it's up to the software developers to implement HID support, not Pioneer. They enabled it. It's there. It's there for the picking. So for all those people who are asking, for instance, why it is taking Pioneer DJ so long for Serato to have HID functionality, that's not Pioneer's problem. That is Serato who is taking their time to develop the CDJ integration, the CDJ3000 integration with Serato. And for good reasons, of course, because this is stuff that you only can do right. There is no in between. You shouldn't do this just a little bit. It should work perfectly or not at all. And I was amazed to see Native Instruments implementing this quick. But on the other hand, of course, Traktor is still the base DJ software for a lot of big name DJs who just use, like me, Traktor as their base DJ software, and then use the DJ converter utility to convert to Rekordbox. So it makes sense that they jumped on that pretty quickly, and they did a great job on it. Kevin Besser, I'm happy for all CDJ users for the quick support, but having the denim players is in the dust is a real shame. But leaving the denim players in the dust is a real shame. Not sure what you mean by that, Kevin. You know that Denon is my preferred performance platform. I don't like the Denon DA, the Denon digital audio conversion. That is really crap. So I really prefer the Pioneer part of that. Or, for instance, with my 6000 amps, I like to use Xone DB4 digitally connected to the players and then back to the Nexus 2. Nobody is left in the dust here. This is just the industry standard. And yes, it has different functionality, but this is what it is. And it is the same story that goes for Pioneer DJ, goes for Denon DJ. If a big name software company wants to incorporate HID functionality all right, I get into that, Kevin. If a software company wants to incorporate HID functionality for new players, they can do it. They just have to write a letter to InMusic/DJ and say, all right, we want to do HID integration for this. And then they get the package to do that. The question is, will they do it? Because, of course, they look at the user base. And I think the Traktor user base is not the same as the Serato user base. First of all, there is a big difference between those two camps. And second of all, I think that the Traktor knows that there are some influential DJs that just like the feeling of the Pioneer gear, and then you can debate if the Denon gear feels better or worse than the Pioneer gear. That's an entirely different discussion. But I was amazed by how sweet this feels, even compared to something reasonably new like the CDJ2000 Nexus 2, which already was industry standard. This feels so much different in a positive way. And I already liked what the CDJ2000 did. So I see things there. I also saw a lot of people online asking, yeah, but who is going to buy 2,400 euro players to control DJ software? Let's face it, folks, there is nothing else. I'm a Traktor user by legacy. I want to stay on Traktor for many reasons, but because I like it is one of them. And I had no other choice if I was aiming for full-size jog wheels to go to a Pioneer HID mode device. And that's how the CDJ2000 Nexus 2 showed up. Lucky for me, I also need these players to test out the various functionality of my own software, of my conversion tool. So that's a two for one. I get kind of the best of both worlds. But I can entirely understand if someone says, all right, I want these things just to control my Traktor. Because if you have felt how it works, if you have felt how smooth it works and how smooth the integration with Traktor is, then you want to use those and nothing else. I even doubt, and this is a bold statement, but I even doubt if I want to use my 6000 M's as a controller for Traktor. This feels better. This feels better. I just have to say, I just said it. This feels better. However, if I'm performing, I prefer the CDJ 6000 M's in standalone mode. And one of the reasons for that is because an audience likes to see moving parts. And that sounds silly, but it is just the way it is. They just like to see turntable-like things that are moving, people who are doing things on those turntables, because that makes much more sense than somebody just pushing a jog wheel and pushing some buttons. To the untrained eye, that seems like button pushing, and working on a 6000 M looks like, all right, the guy is doing something meaningful. So that is a completely different structure. But if you are strictly talking about control for Traktor from controller standpoint, there is really nothing that will beat what I have right in front of me. There is really nothing better than what is being used here. This is, I haven't felt anything like this before. This is something completely new. So I can highly, highly, highly recommend that. All right, enough sucking dick of Native Instruments and Pioneer DJ. Because, and don't get me wrong, I'm not on the payroll of any of those companies. If I say that I like it, I just like it. Same that if I say I think something is crap, then I think something is crap. And there is no second agenda there or interest differently than just saying my feelings. Another thing that is brand new with this version of Recordbox is the integration of Beatport LINK and Beatsource LINK. And I saw my friend Chris Mojax already doing a short piece on this. However, he made some errors, and Chris usually is pretty punctual about what he does. But one of the things that he got wrong is one of the things I think is very important. Namely this, if you are in Beatport, and let's go into one of the playlists. There we are. Right now, I cannot analyze the tracks because I am under the Beatport section. Hold on, I'm not even on screen. There I am. All right. Right here, I'm under the Beatport section of Traktor. And that means that the tracks you see right here are tracks on Beatport, obviously. Now, those tracks are not part of my collection yet. The collection is there, track collection. You can see they are not there. That also means I cannot analyze them. If I right click here, you see there is no analysis option available in it. You cannot say, all right, analyze the tracks. However, if you import the tracks to the collection, and I do an import playlist because I want, for instance, this playlist in Traktor, then it asks me to name it. Well, let's just give it the same name. Who cares? All of a sudden, you see the cover art appearing there. That means there is some interaction going on between Traktor and Beatport, namely getting the metadata from it. There is still no analysis data. Those tracks are not analyzed yet. The BPM you see right there is the BPM straight from Beatport. So it is a question, does it work or not? However, because those tracks are now inside my collection, I can easily select them all, right click them and say analyze. Exactly that. It will hurt maybe the quality of my video a little bit if I let it kick in, but I just want to demonstrate this. You can see under in the bottom that it is analyzing the tracks. It does that pretty fast, pretty quickly. And the moment it's done, those tracks are analyzed and I can just load them up and they will be immediately available, as you can see. So that is pretty good. That is exactly what he wanted to see and what I wanted to see, namely, you can analyze at home and you don't have to wait for all the tracks or load all the tracks in one by one. You can just analyze them at home by taking the playlists from Beatport. One of the fun parts of Traktor is that it can have Beatport link and Beatsource link both open at the same time. Serato can only have one of them open at the same time. Rekordbox can do it too. DJ from Algorithm can do it, but the rest cannot do that. So mainly Serato. Another real fun thing is that you can mix and match tracks in the same playlist. So I can put some Beatport tracks in it in my regular playlist and just order them, and they will still appear as a normal playlist. The only difference is that you see the little Beatport thingy in front of them, indicating that, all right, this track is on Beatport and not from your local collection. I saw a question. Mixmaster G, I have the DJ conversion utility mixed in key record box, Q and key two, etc. I still can't anything together. Please help. That's a lot of questions, Eddie. But before, please help, what do you want to do? Because that is always the main question. What do you want to do? I cannot answer that by just you naming the tools. I need to know what is the thing that you want to do. What is your base DJ software? Do you have mixed key installed? Where do you want to make your preparations? Where do you want to convert to? ICT, the iTunes collection tool, is totally separate from all the other DJ software because that's an iTunes only tool. So I cannot answer that question, my friend, unless I know exactly what you want to do, and then I'm happy to help you out. But not like this. I cannot help you like this. That's a fact. Back to where we were. So in Traktor, we have this. Now, There is another tool of mine that not many people know about, and that is called the DJ Conversion Utility Streaming. And that DJ Conversion Utility Streaming can convert DJ metadata from tracks that are on audio streaming services like Beatport LINK or Beatsource LINK or even Tidal between DJ software. It will not rip those tracks, so it's not an audio ripper. It will not import those tracks locally. No, they stay on the audio streaming service they are. But for instance, if let's take a track, why not? Back to my roots, and let's switch, because we can, to the HID mode, and let's just give it a cue there, and then let's move along a little bit further. See what's happening there, like here, for instance. Let's give it a cue there, and then let's give it a catch loop near the end, because we like our catch loops, don't we? I have to tell you something about catch loops later on, by the way, as well. So I will do that later on, but let's just put a catch loop there. So this tool now got, or this track now got two cues and it got a loop. And let's say I name this one. Let's do it without the tracks first. Let's do it straightforward. So I have back to my roots. The track has some cues and loops set in Traktor. If I quit Traktor here, switch my screen again, fire up the DJ Conversion Utility Streaming. And we tell it that we come from Beatport LINK, we come from Traktor, and we want to go to Serato and Recordbox. Why not? We take them both. And you can do that at the same time. This will be really quick. Hey, TechnoBeat TV, good to see you, my friend, and happy to see you. Yes, I'm usually hanging out in Phil's streams just to help out and to answer questions wherever I can. So what did I do? I just converted the cues and loops I set in that particular track. So let's fire up Recordbox and see if we can find that track. And this is the straightforward part, the fun part, the real fun part. This is already powerful, but there is even more fun possible. If we go into this, then we have the Back to My Roots track it was, but I don't see it right here. Ah, there it is. It was not analyzed. There we go. And there you see the cues we set and the loop we set, and they are set both as a HOT and as a memory cue. So you have both there. The same, by the way, for Serato. If I go to Serato right here and load up that particular track, see if we can quickly find it. I think it was there. Not sure in which playlist it was. Let's wait for it to open up. It's still starting up. Oh, that might be because server is not mounted. I don't know. Back to, always good if you remember. Direct playlist, no. What playlist was it in? I don't know. I thought it was here. Back to my roots, there it is indeed. And we load it up. Then you can see that the cues are appearing there. Track needs to be analyzed, and if we go to the loop section and we dive down a little bit, you see that even the loop is there. So this is pretty powerful stuff. You can set just your cues and loops in. I can set them in Serato and convert them back to Traktor and Recordbox. It just operates between everything. Now, Traktor users always are at a disadvantage because we don't have colored memory cues. We cannot set the color of a cue. There is a load cue that can have a particular color, and we have an intro cue that can have a particular color, but you cannot freely choose the colors of your cues. What I did to battle that is design something called the Cue and Loop Parameters tool. It comes free with all my tools, And what this does is basically translate a queue name or an abbreviation to a particular color. So here you see the list, and you can edit it. You can enter yourself, enter them yourself. Let's say we want to have the hash AMA queue. Ask me anything, and then that should be a. Let's take a different color. Let's take a gold color. This means that if I go back to my tractor, let's store this up. If I go back to my tractor, that is record box. I still confuse those two, though. Those icons are too much alike. When I was developing the record box queue and key tool in the past few weeks, the number of times that I started tractor instead of record box and vice versa was countless. So there is really, really, really a lot going on there. Let's take a different track. Why not priority? Let's give it a queue there. Oh, we are no longer in hit mode. So, and this is what I meant, folks. Then the problem starts because if you want to go into hit mode, it allows me to go back into it. And usually you have to restart the whole thing, but this time not. This time we were lucky enough to have it like this. Let's put something there and let's put a catch loop right there. And let's call the catch loop hashtag CL because that's an existing thing. And let's call this one hashtag AMA. And I have to double check if I did. Yep, that came over, that came over, that came over. And let's pretend that this is a vocal, hashtag vocal. Now I've named those queues. The fun part is if I'm going to convert these, they will get the colors and the full name I defined them at. And this is not restricted to Traktor. CLP works with all my conversion tools, even with the Recordbox queue and key tool. If you stay on Recordbox, however, you want to have a uniform colorway. You want to make sure that all the vocals are that color and all the breaks are that color and all the drops are that color. Then you can do that with CLP. Just CLP the whole thing or all your cues and then work them through the Recordbox queue and key tool, and you will have similar colors for similar settings. So I did it for this. This track is called Priority, just to make sure that I don't forget what we were working with. Let's quit Traktor here. Fire up the DJ Converse Utility Streaming. And then let's go from a Beatport link from Traktor to Recordbox and Serato. And again, this is a pretty quick and reasonably fast process because it's just metadata being converted. So that works reasonably well. Let's have a look in Serato first. And then we have to find the priority track. It should be in this playlist. There it is already. But I have to wait for Serato to free up like this. And there you can see that indeed the vocal has become green and you see the full name vocal. The ask me anything is become yellow because I defined that in the CLP. And if you go down the list here, loops don't have a color for tracks from streaming services. The color is converted, however, but Serato is not displaying it. And if we do the same thing in Recordbox, you can see that also the colors, etc., came over there. So you are pretty good to go then. Let's go back to Recordbox. And then let's find the track that we converted, and that was priority. And there you see again the colors and the names are fully automatically set. Talking about loops, and to be precise, active loops. An active loop is a loop that automatically arms the moment the playback head hits the loop section. There's the loop section. This is not an active loop. So if I start playing this track right here, we are not in hit mode, so I have to do it like that. It will not start to loop because it is not an active loop. See, nothing happening. Now let me go back a little bit. However, because my tools always convert, depending on your settings, to both memory and hot cues, you can make one memory loop, only one, and only in the memory cue bank, an active loop. You do that by clicking the little orange symbol, so it becomes red. And if I play it back now, that loop will automatically arm the moment the playback head, you see, enters. Then it will arm. That's why it's an active loop. This is very useful. It has saved my ass many times over the years because I missed my mix window or my mix out window or whatever. I went to the toilet. So active loops are very powerful. There is only one thing. Active loops cannot be exported to XML, and active loops cannot be imported from XML, which means there is no way to get active information in or out of record box. So if you import information from different DJ software, that active loop will get lost if you use an XML, like the DJ conversion utility always uses XMLs to get their information in or out. It is a restriction of record box. Pioneer DJ knows about it, and maybe in the future they will do something about it, but that's the way things are right now. So you cannot make a loop active even if you know exactly which loop you want to be active. And if a loop is active, you will lose it the moment you import XML information. I see there are some questions. Eddie Michael, that is the guy who had the question about all the various tools. I want to have a perfect library. Start with ICT. That's correct. I use Recordbox and Mixnicki. Then things are very easy, my friend. You start indeed with making the basis correct. And the basis in your case are iTunes. Once all those tracks in iTunes are correct and your playlists in iTunes are exactly the way you are, and you have taken care of all the duplicates, and that's something that ICT all can help you with because it's designed to do that shit, then the only thing you have to do in Recordbox, let me switch back to export mode because that makes things a little bit easier. And the moment you click the sync manager, you can just say synchronize iTunes playlists. And you switch it on, you want them all, and you click the big gray thingy there. And from that moment on, everything is on automatic. That means that Recordbox now knows about your iTunes collection. It knows about the tracks that are inside of it right here. And you can even access them. You can see, well, I don't know what is there, but there is some. You see, there's some stuff there. That's coming from my iTunes collection. Now, mind you, they are not inside my Recordbox collection yet. This is my Recordbox collection. And before you continue to do that, you need to make them part of the Recordbox collection. And if you want to use the Recordbox cue and key tool, that is my tool that integrates mixed key data with Recordbox, you have to make sure that all tracks are analyzed, because the analysis of the tracks is used to convert the mixed in key cues. So the next thing you want to do is first make sure that those tracks are inside your Recordbox collection. And the next thing is you switch on in the preferences the auto analysis. And that is, let me see where that is hidden. I think under analysis makes sense, right? Enable this one and make sure that the track analysis setting is set for BPM/grid. Now you can see that it immediately kicked in. It's starting to analyze right away. Before you do anything else, you switch on the iTunes integration using the sync manager. That is this thing in the lower left corner. Make sure that the settings are like this. Press the gray button. make sure that the analysis are automatically kicking in with BeatGrid, etc. enabled. And then it's just a matter of following the REC tutorial to get your mixing key data inside the record box. Sorry, Eddie. Sorry, my friend. This is exactly what I meant. Let me take it from the top very quickly. What you need to do is enable the sync manager right here. Make sure that, let me switch it off. Make sure that this one is enabled, that one or playlist is enabled, and press that big gray button. Then everything is imported into Recordbox. In my instance, it was not analyzed, and you can see right here that it is still working on the analysis, but you can make that an automatic process if you go to the preferences analysis. So not this one, but this tab. Make sure that auto analysis is enabled. And also make sure that the track analysis setting is for BPM and grid, because REC needs to have a first beat marker. The location of that first beat marker is important, because if that location is not the same location as that mixing key analyzed, then you get an entire shift by one or two or three beats of a cue set by mixing key. And that is not something you normally want. So that is what you need to do. And after that, it is just follow the REC tutorial, how to get your mixing key cues and all the other information into Recordbox. And that will work fine. Only thing you have to keep in mind is that current versions of Recordbox are plagued with what is called the XML import bug. And that just means that whenever you are true, and let me just quickly do this, because we are waiting for it anyway. It's still analyzing the tracks. Let's make sure that those tracks are inside mixing key. So let me fire up mixing key there. I accept. Oh, hold on. I don't have. Problem is, I have the beta of REC installed and not the normal REC version, which also means that I cannot showcase it like I said at the beginning of this stream. So you have to wait for that. But if you run into troubles, don't hesitate. Contact me over either Facebook Messenger or over email or whatever. If you run into problems, I'm always there to help you out. And if it's something interesting enough, I will be happy to share it with the crowd on the AMA streams, because that is what these streams are for. But if your iTunes collection is already the way it is supposed to be, then the next steps is just following the tutorials. Your iTunes collection in order is your main thing. And after that, and after you've got all that information in, things become a lot easier, because you use the iTunes collection tool to introduce new tracks to your iTunes collection, sync them up with Recordbox, and process them the way it needs to be processed. So that's pretty straightforward stuff, but I can understand if it's a lot. If you don't get it, contact me. Then Eddie has a question. I currently have ICT running on my laptop. It has found 421 duplicates. ICT has been waiting for music to cool down for 3 hours now. Is this normal? Yes and no, Eddie. The problem with iTunes or the music app, because I just named it iTunes to make things easier, is that ICT uses Apple script commands to control what is going on in iTunes. And that's a wonderful technology, because you can virtually control everything that's going on in iTunes through Apple script. However, there is one very important drawback. iTunes doesn't process the commands you send to it in the same sequence as they are sent. It's non-linear, as we call it. And that is a problem, because I don't want to put, very simply put, a track into a playlist if that playlist is not already created. In order to prevent that from happening, there is a safeguard working inside ICT that always checks, is iTunes busy? And if iTunes is busy, I wait with my next thing. If ICT has been fully finished and it is now waiting to cool down for the quitting, then you can quit it just fine. One of the things going on in the back that might disturb ICT and make it think that iTunes is very busy processing all kind of commands it sent, is the library sharing function of iTunes. Let me get into that. Because I found out if that is active, if the library sharing is active, and on Catalina it is hidden in a different segment, but right here I should be able to find it. Let's see if I can find it somewhere. Sharing, right there. And you can see send libraries are disabled in the restrictions preferences, and that's right here. And that's exactly what I would suggest you do. Disable that immediately. And podcasts might be disabled as well. Internet radio, iTunes store disabled, this all disabled, and shared libraries disabled. That way, you know that the only thing going on in iTunes is actually the stuff ICT sent and not some functionality that you maybe have enabled without you even knowing it. So that's something that you need to do, and I need to include that in the tutorial for ICT, because it can make all the difference to disable that kind of stuff. Then I saw another question appearing. Let's see. Also, how do you queue and key tools deal with mixing key values like 12A and 0A? Good question again, my friend. They put a zero in front of it. It is as simple, actually. Let me fire up my tractor again, because I think the tracks, the test tracks I had, should have that information. Let's see. Let's. Oh, then. Oh, hold on. You see them right here. Key text is the T, and you see they put a zero in front of values below 10, which make it sortable. You can now sort on it, as you can see. And the same, by the way, for the command fields. The command fields put a zero in front of commands or keys below 10, and a zero in front of BPMs below 100. So again, this thing becomes entirely, there's nothing below 100 in my collection, but it puts a zero in front of it, take my word for it. So that makes all those things sortable, and that makes life a little bit easier. I can show, I can fire up rec, because that will do just fine. Where is my rec? There it is. You're welcome, Eddie, and reach out if you are stuck, because I really here to help. And this stuff is made for exactly what you want, to make your library as smooth and as organized as possible. Another thing I really can recommend you is, I've got these workflow videos I do. Basically, it is me doing my weekly workflow, but then I stream it directly for all you guys to see what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. I can really recommend you to have a look at one of the recent workflow videos, because there you see me doing all this stuff. Of course, Traktor is my base DJ software. Yours is Rekordbox, but the whole philosophy behind it, and I explain it all in detail there, is the same for Traktor as it is for Rekordbox as it is for Traktor. Just name it, just use Rekordbox wherever I use Traktor. I'm not sure why it is not showing up. Ah, there it is. All right, here we go. Eddie, here comes your question. You see this little thing, key preceding zero for values lower than 10. You can even switch it on or switch it off. That is also written to the file tags. So that key with or without a zero is also in the file tags. These are all the possibilities for the command field. And again, it will put a zero in front of it or not, just, or it will always put a zero. The command field will always be sortable, and whatever you want in the command field is controllable by you. You can see all the options are there for you to pick from. By default, it goes with key, BPM, energy. So that's that. One important thing to keep in mind, for instance, Rekordbox understands if there is a zero in front of a Camelot key and will import it just fine. But within Rekordbox, it will not display a zero. It will just display 1A or 2B instead of 2 of 0 to B, which might be in the XML file. That is because internally, Rekordbox doesn't use Camelot keys at all. It uses something entirely different. And what you see on your screen in Rekordbox is a representation of what it uses internally. And that representation doesn't have added zeros, but it doesn't need them either because it sorts correctly. And for instance, Denon Prime, the Engine Prime does do the exact same thing. You can put tracks in it with a zero in front of the key, but then it will translate them to its own internal system, which will not display the zero, but they will sort correctly. However, with Engine Prime, the sorting order is totally fucked up because they start at 8A as the first key in a sorting row and then go down the list instead of 1A. And their reason behind it is that 8A is the 8 minor or the A minor key in the normal key thing. But I find that a very strange solution. If you are a Camelot, it should start with 1 and not with 8A. Any more questions, my friends? Because I'm here to answer them. And otherwise, we are going toward the end of this stream. I do this every Tuesday. However, next Tuesday, I won't be there because my little niece has her birthday. So I have different things to do. But the week after that, and that is, let me find it in the agenda when that is. You will see the announcement. The week after that, I will have my close friend Jeroen Groenendijk together with me in the studio. And we are going to deep dive into Rekordbox and all things Pioneer. For those who don't know who Jeroen is the product manager of Pioneer DJ Europe. And he knows all things Pioneer. We can rival about what we like and what we don't like. We can talk for ages why I think that iTunes is the best collection manager you can use, and he thinks it sucks. But we are both very knowledgeable about this. The idea behind the stream is that we are going inside the Rekordbox track editor, which is built in, and I never used it, but I'm sure you guys never used it either, but it is supposed to be very powerful. So I want to deep dive into that part with him. And of course, we are here to answer any and all questions you guys might have about the Rekordbox Pioneer. And if it's outside the scope of Rekordbox Pioneer, then it will be my job to answer them. I see Anthony has something. Kevin, thanks. It was informative and fun to watch. Unlike soccer, yeah. Especially unlike the Dutch European soccer, because, man, I'm sometimes ashamed to see that. Anthony Brown, thank you so much for another good session for us. I am extremely grateful, MixMaster G. Have a great weekend, sir. The same to you, Anthony. Thank you for always tuning on. I appreciate that. Thank you, my friend. Hi, MixMaster G. DJ Long G here. My first time on Twitch. You've never been on Twitch, my friend. Then you are in for a treat, because there is a host of great DJs on Twitch, and there is a host of good information to be found on Twitch. Of course, we have Cleveland Terry doing shows on Twitch. We've got Kova of Tweak Music Tips that I can highly recommend. We have Mike Marquise, and Mike is best known for being the DJ who goes out on the streets in New York. I don't know exactly what his schedule is, but he goes out on the streets with a portable DJ set and just DJs on the street. And one time it is the sunset and the other time it is the sunrise that he DJs at. But he also hosts a great show. And on that show, he has the biggest names as guests. And he had guys like John Jellybean Benitez as a guest. So if you want to see something, find DJ Mike Marquise and watch his streams, because they are informative, they are fun, and he sometimes have great guests, but not many people know about this. So that's why I want to just give it a shout out. Go see and watch that. I will be here within 14 days from now with Jeroen Groenendijk as my guest, and we are going to deep dive into the Pioneer DJ ecosystem. For all of you who are right now on YouTube and Facebook, I will disconnect the stream in a moment. And for everybody else, we will see who is on and who we can rate into. Thank you all for watching. If you got new questions, just drop them in the comments right below the video. Reach out to me over Facebook or by email, and I'm happy to answer them. Don't forget, if you like what I'm doing, to give this video the thumbs up, to tell your DJ friends about it, to ring the bell, and to do all those other things that support people like me, because I'm not interested in becoming the biggest influencer ever, but I just hope to help other guys out with the knowledge I accumulated. Thank you all for watching. Twitch watchers, stay close, because we are going to raid into somebody, but I always have to first make sure that I disable the stream on YouTube and Facebook, because the last time I did,